Headset up. All right, we are on. So, as I said, we always have a choice. Whatever happens to us, we are the master of our fate and the captain of our soul. If you lose your soul, don't blame anyone else, blame yourself. Or if you succeed, don't praise anyone else, praise yourself. All right? Many bosses, you know, when they give a promotion, there's a ritual in companies, you know. You shouldn't just send a letter by post. That's not good, because that's not good management. It's your people, they work with you all the time. So when you have to give them good news, a promotion or an increment, you should call them to your cabin and tell them that you've done good work, you've done great work, and I'm pleased to, you know, give you this promotion letter and so on. Okay? And that is the moment you say, thank you, sir, and this, that. And very nice, I'm so happy, please accept my thanks. And good managers then say, don't thank me. You thank yourself, because you have earned this. If I have given it to you, it has no value at all. Right? But if you have earned it, it has great value. You have earned it. You don't have to thank me. So, another tip I have given you. Say this, it will be appreciated. Now, someone objected, you know, why are we talking of leaders versus managers? Are we pitting one against the other? Huh? Are we making a fight, dispute, who is manager, who is leader and so on? But nevertheless, we concluded the first session of today's class by saying we all recognize that there is something there which is a little extra in a leader, which may not be there in a manager. And then this is adapted again from Warren Bennis, this is spelt wrong. He makes a kind of comparison, you know, managers and leaders, and they say one administers, the other innovates. What is the difference between administer and innovate? Administering is what? Managing? Planning, directing, leading, controlling.
So you are following a set of procedures, you are administering.
You are administering, following. So managing complexity in some ways, through rules, procedures, right? And what is innovating? That you don't care for the rules and all that, right? To hell with the rules. Innovating means that part of your time, you try to see how you can do your own job in a different way, which necessarily is a better way. We were talking a little while ago during the 5-minute break about good companies when they have appraisal of people at the end of the year or at the end of half year or at the end of the quarter. They have, of course, formalized forms and so on. And then one of the things they have is leadership. They want to know that this particular person whom we are appraising, what are his leadership potential and qualities and attributes, okay? And another column talks of innovative ability, innovative. And in fact, most of these appraisal systems, they are bilateral systems. That means at the beginning of the year or the beginning of the appraisal period, you have to have the employee set his own goals and then discuss it with his superior and have an agreement that we agree that this is what is my goal and tasks and targets for the coming year. And that is then reviewed. Okay? And when you set your goals, one of the goals you have to set is what are these things which you will do a little differently than you have done in the last year. This is one of the targets or one of the objectives which you have to set. This is to encourage innovation amongst people, to set them thinking. Okay. Now, innovate is what he feels is what managers must do beyond managing, and that takes them into the area of leadership, innovation. Maintain and develop. What does that mean? You maintain something and you develop something. Maintenance. I remember in brick and mortar industry at least, engineers from fine schools and all, like IIT, they didn't want to get into maintenance at all. Why is that? Because they felt there's no excitement. Your machinery is there in the workshop. If it goes bad, you go and repair it. They felt it's not a lead role. It's a following role, you know. You're a staff kind of department. You're not a line department. So that connotation is used here. It says you maintain, like Neeraj said, administer. That means nothing new you're doing. Someone has laid down the rules, procedures, etc., and you're administering them. That means you're saying that they are followed. So that is the connotation here, maintaining versus developing. Developing, you know, like all engineers, they want to join research and development. No? Development has a connotation of something very good, something very bright, innovative. Okay? Product development, design development, these are all words which carry a meaning and a connotation of something which is really, you know, state of the art that you are doing. Okay? So from that. Then it says focus on systems and structure and focus on people. Now this is interesting. We are all taught in engineering, and most of us are engineers, barring two of them coincidentally sitting side by side. Okay? I don't think we should read meaning into it, but we are taught, you know, that focus on system, structure, all this. So many of us want to do systems as an elective, no? But here you see it says leaders, they are more people oriented, because you have to lead people. When you come right down to it, it seems so self-evident, isn't it? Who are you going to lead? Are you going to lead machines? Are you going to lead systems or computers? You are essentially going to lead people. So people oriented, focus on people, rely on control, inspire trust. By control, what he means is command and control. That is a boss-subordinate relationship. These are the rules, this is the discipline, you do it. As against that, the leaders, they try to inspire trust. If you trust me, do what I ask you to do. It's good for you, it's good for the organization, it's good for me too. Short-range view and long-range perspective. So, what does that mean? Yesterday, all of us, we heard some lecture by Mr. Sandeep Naik. That was long range perspective, no? So, that was strategy. So, vision, mission, strategy. We discussed that a little while ago. They say this is what leaders should be doing apart from the other work. Then asks how and when is what managers do, and asks what and why. Eyes on the bottom line, eyes on the horizon. So does it mean that leaders will take a company into bankruptcy? He is looking at the horizon while the bottom line is going down, down till it's awash in red. Does it mean so? Obviously not. If you are a CEO and you are a leader, don't you have to watch the bottom line also? So what they really mean is the focus. Focus is don't watch bottom line to the exclusion of looking at the horizon. And implicit in that is horizon is important. Why? Because you are watching the environment then. The environment has a terrific impact on the company. Is health, profitability. So as a leader, you have to watch it some of the time. But at the same time, you have to watch in order to prosper in the long run, as people say. You have to survive in the short run. If you die today, where is your Where is your future and your strategy? Can't die. But you know, in some of us who had the advantage of doing internship in America, and we have four of us here, right? Have you all four?
Yes.
Okay. What do you find the American managers or leaders? What is their orientation today? Did you observe that?
It's a mix of both.
Mix of both.
Handling. There has to be some goal orientation.
But where do they put more emphasis? I mean, this is your subjective judgment. From whatever little you saw, you know, you saw one company and you were there for 5 months.
Currently it is the bottom line.
Currently is the bottom line.
The situation being bad over there.
So yes. It's environment specific, is it not? Yes?
So I found work experience I found in my company at Infosys. Infosys are much more, posturing me to learn, keep changing, ready for change management types. Whereas in the company abroad, American Express, it wasn't that kind of thing. It was more of a spongy kind of a place that, it is every week, Monday afternoons, you have to give a status report of all the projects and very boring meeting and then come back and do the work.
So why do you think? You must have analyzed this. Why do you think this difference? It's quite a radical difference. Why? Do you think it's something to do with leadership? Anyone would like to say why? Why is this?
This is a growing organization or it is already a developed organization. The culture will be different.
In what way different?
But if you refer to the Hofstede theory, we can take examples of Indian firms where the application of rules and other systems are done on a very non-written basis. I mean, things happen on a very subjective level. Whereas if you take our business organizations in the US and the European countries, where people tend to perform better when they are subject to rules and other regulations. In India, even if the rules and regulations exist, performance is more affected by the subjective behavior of the people who matter.
Mm. So it's also influenced by the type of industry they are in, sir. So they are a technology company, they are always running to be ahead of the current technology and they have to be ready for the change. But for the kind of company American Express is, they are in the one single business of, say, so they are in banking, it's also changing, but since they are a bigger organization, they can, so things like
stagnancy. American Express started.
Let him state his view. I mean, let's respect the views of people. then we'll debate.
No, he's saying one company is changing, the other company is not changing, but the other company has changed much more than the first company. American Express started as a parcel transport company.
This whole interaction is a learning process also. I'll give you an example, what you said. Do you think Tin Plate Company Limited is a fast changing company kind of thing or?
Yes, sir. Right now, it is in the fast changing mode.
That industry is fast changing?
No, sir.
The company has changed. But what about the industry? So, when you say American Express, you are saying it's in a stodgy kind of banking industry and all that. Don't you think that even steel industry is more or less in the same league? But within the industry, one company has done wonders. That is Tin Plate Company. So, that's why he is disagreeing. He say that's not the reason. There can be winners, okay, in all types of environments, all types of industries. And the interesting point made by Viraj, who quoted some theory and said that basically the finding is that Indian companies, all right, if they are subject to rules, regulations, etc., that doesn't seem to correlate with their performance, okay. Whereas in American companies or first world countries, if their rules, procedures, etc., accountability, they seem to do better. Is that what you said? Even in companies like Microsoft, for instance.
The comparison is a bit difficult. I mean, you have to take companies even in the same area of work and the same geographical location. I mean, if you have to compare Infosys, it's better to compare Infosys with Wipro or TCS for that matter. If you have to compare MX, then you, it's better to compare MX with some other big organization in the US or in the European
So that it will be a more apt comparison. Is that what you are saying?
Yes, sir.
Sure.
Yes, there was. What is your view? You have been 5 months now.
Right. First, I would like
in
to
America.
Comment on what Srivath said.
Huh.
The example he gave, that the role he was performing, maybe it was because of the kind of work he was doing. Infosys might be grooming him as a future employee while he was there in an American Express for a temporary work. So there, the nature of work is like that they might to extract that whatever work they can. They are not trying to groom him, while Infosys is trying to groom him as a future employee. That might have an impact.
So what kind of experience did you have vis-a-vis what you just said?
In where you worked in America? Right, the question you asked, what I felt was the procedures in a work, for a day-to-day work, is much more defined as in US rather than India. India, where I, whatever little experience I have, the person has been given work and he finds his own way to do it. While there, the procedures and the methods are laid down. The work culture is more of a deadline driven. It doesn't matter you work in night or day. It's depend on you should supposed to deliver.
Targets are sacrosanct.
Yeah, and you are supposed to deliver, otherwise you are out. Here it's not like that. You are given so much leeway. Even if you don't perform, there is no firing or such extreme
steps.
I would like
to totally disagree with
that.
All right, we'll get you a chance. Anything else?
The other thing is the goal. The company we work for, the kind of project I worked on, was supposed to be, is going to be implemented in 2004. And they like to plan and think out in such an advance. While I don't see many companies in India doing for a routine, I mean for a small work, even plan out such in such advance and try to hone down to a small particular strategy for small things. So that is a big difference there and here.
Okay. Yes.
Agree to everything except for the fact that if you don't do your work, you are not in the firing line. You are very much in the firing line even in Indian companies.
Not the firing line. You may not have a job next day there if you don't perform.
That's even with
that's
Indian
the
companies.
Social reality in India and US. I mean, you cannot.
That is fine. It's a social reality is something which is accepted there and not here. People don't get pink slips as often as in America as in India.
If you don't perform, it happens.
Yeah.
So, what is the reason for the difference in the nature of job is because the United States or the developed country has the resources or has the experience, and they have developed their GDP to a such extent, or more specifically industry to a such extent that they can afford to have a specialist. I became to know that there is a programmer who programs for continuously for 10-15 years, and then he charges $300-$400 an hour. While in India, we neither can afford to have one person programming just C for 10 years, and we will be able to give you so much money because our.
So what is the point you're making?
Point I'm making is our economy is not developed to that extent in which we can afford to have a specialist in any particular field. We need to have some generalists.
Sir, I would like to comment on the culture of working.
Okay.
Here, most of the important decisions are taken in very informal settings. Even when the different delegations and persons from the companies, the kind of setting is very informal. Where if you look at India, they are very strict norms, they are very strict procedures, proper dress code and stuff like that, which is
which is not the case with US. It's very friendly environment.
I'm sure your sample size was big enough, because I suspect it may not be so. You know, the company you worked in is kind of informal.
So maybe we work in the IT department.
It's kind of informal.
Yeah.
But there are many industries which are quite formal. I mean, if you look at the number of black suited briefcase chaps going around New York or bigger cities. Yes.
This particular change in attitude in the so-called US firm is very recent. I mean, even if they are happening, they just look informal. They are more formal than what happens in the Indian settings. Indian settings, individuals may be dressed in a formal manner, the settings may be formal, but the going on may end up being an informal one. But in the US settings, even if a meeting is held in a restaurant or or any other informal setting, the proceedings are highly formal. They may not look formal.
So which is better?
India.
It all depends. That's right. Huh? Nothing is really cut and dried. Okay. Now, just to run through this, imitate and originate, which is again innovating and so on. Accept the status quo, challenge the status quo. Huh? Have you challenged any status quo at all in the last 6 months, any one of you? Darshpreet, you have challenged any status quo in the last 6 months?
Our project in Ashok Leyland was to just challenge the status quo.
Okay.
We were working on the engineering. Huh. We analyzed each process, the number of process owners, the way the documents are moving, and the relationships between the different departments.
Good. That's good. You know, somewhere before, there was a phrase which I used, leaders, you know, they shift the paradigm. Okay? Paradigm. What is a paradigm? Do you know, we hear of this word with a difficult spelling. But what is the meaning of paradigm? You can all spell paradigm, right? P-A-R-A-D-I-M-E. All right. So what is paradigm?
It's a frame of reference.
Frame of reference.
So lateral shift.
Like example?
So lateral shift.
May let him give an example. Frame of reference. Like what?
Okay,
think about it. Alright. You said something? Yes. Paradigm?
It's a lateral or a substantial shift.
Lateral or lateral shift? Shift of what?
In a pattern
of thinking.
Yes.
Essentially is to do with thinking. Alright? That this can be done, this can't be done. That's a pattern of thinking. So shifting of paradigm. Paradigm is a word which became very popular in the 1980s. You find it really was extremely popular. And now, I don't know, of late in the new millennium, it's losing a bit of its potency, I think, because new things are coming in and they replace the old. A lot of research, I said, was done here, and this is the Iowa Leadership Studies in the 1930s, way back 70 years. And what were they trying to research? They were really trying to research what leadership behaviors would have as their outcome. Right? And this was one research which was done by having three different styles of leadership. This was a research parameter. And the subject, the target group was hobby clubs. Hobby clubs, you understand? In America, they have these hobby clubs, photographic club or aero modeling club and so on for the children. So this was a hobby club, 10-year-old boys. Each club subjected to three different styles of leadership: authoritarian, democratic, and laissez-faire. What is What is that? Anyone tell me what is authoritarian? Authoritarian. That is, you give authority to the people.
Wielding one's power.
Group of persons.
What? Wielding power.
One person gives commands and directions, and others follow.
Authoritarian. One man. Dictatorship, would you say? Authoritarian?
No.
Totalitarian? No?
Yes.
Yes. But why is that hesitant thing, Neeraj?
Sir, not exactly.
You are not quite sure.
No, sir, I'm sure, but
then?
Sir, that's a very crude term, dictatorship. It's not okay. That good.
All right. Authoritarian. Come, Viraj, you tell me. What is authoritarian? What does it mean? It really means that whoever is the boss, he feels that everything, all decisions, etc., he should take himself. I mean, he is not very, very amenable to listening to any other people. He has the authority, he is a boss, and he does what he thinks best. Would you agree with that? That's authoritarian. All right. Now, what is democratic? Democratic means what? That you are the boss, but you are equal. You know, it's for the people, of the people, for the people, and by the people. So you are boss, and then you say, all right, you guys, you decide. Is that what is democratic style of leadership?
I rather call it democracy in corporations as participative management.
So he is bringing in another concept of participative. So is democratic same as participative? Are you serious about it? Huh? That is authoritarian participatory model? Huh? No, Neeraj, I don't think everyone has to participate in a participatory, but I think the conditions, the atmosphere is conducive, that if what people would like to participate, they participate. Because if you want everyone, then it becomes coercive, doesn't it? It becomes more towards authoritarian. You are forced. Okay, what does democracy? Democratic, I think what they mean here and what they did is that everyone has a say in it, all right? But the decision is taken by the person who is in responsibility, isn't it? In a democracy, someone has to take the responsibility, but others are willing, have their say, and this is given due cognizance of what say is given.
Majority
decision. So basically, you require a clerical facilitator, you know, you throw it to vote and that's it. There's no leader, because we are talking of leadership. In a democracy, democratic way of decision, right, is no doubt by majority, but the democratic way of leadership is what? Even in a democracy, you can have leaders who exhibit style which are highly authoritarian, isn't it? We had a prime minister who shall go unnamed, ruled for 17 years but was highly authoritarian, right or wrong? So, we are talking of styles. So, participative and democratic is essentially more or less the same, you see. You may participate even in a democracy, you don't have to come to the parliament and participate, except one or two rules are there. When you are new MP, you are elected, you are supposed to make a maiden speech, you know, you get your turn. After that, it's not mandatory that you come every time, unless a whip is issued. When there is an important vote, then the whip is issued. Whip issue means everyone is asked, come, hell or high water, you should be present to cast your vote. Okay. So, this experiment which was done, all right, it showed, you know, the outcome was some behavior. Behavior who? Of the target group, these boys. So, those who are subject to authoritarian kind of leadership, they either, you know, these boys, either they showed aggressive behavior or they showed passive behavior. And aggressive behavior is put down to a reaction to authoritarian rule. You know, if you are not being listened to, people don't listen to you, the leader, then you try to react and that reaction is aggressive. But why passive? Another group, it was passive behavior was exhibited, tuned off. Why? Maybe because of frustration. They felt that whatever you might say, nothing is going to come out of it, because you have a leader who is totally authoritarian. So why raise your blood pressure and why raise conflicts? Just tune off, so passive. And that is probably the reason, because you see in bracket, aggressive when leader absent. When the leader left the room or he was not there, then they probably felt that they should now show their true feelings, which was aggression. And the laissez-faire, this is very curious, laissez-faire, what is the meaning of laissez-faire? Take your own decisions. Laissez-faire, take your own decisions, is that it? What is laissez-faire? चलती का नाम गाड़ी, चलता है चलने दो, हाँ, is that what is laissez-faire? What is it? Tell me.
So what does it mean?
And it means
originally what did it mean and today what does it mean?
Originally it meant the free play of market forces. And now it basically means that let things happen as they happen. I mean,
one leader will evolve out of the situation.
Does anyone accept this? Laissez-faire means things will find its natural outcome. Don't try to mold it, channel it, manage it. It will happen. Would you say B.G. Sohm has got a democratic or an authoritarian or a laissez-faire type of management? We'll do a small research on this, I think. Authoritarian? No way? Laissez-faire? Democratic. Authoritarian. Do you think we should research this? Because we don't know, you know, finally, whichever is a style of management, what is the final objective really? Passive authoritarian. All right. I think the final outcome which the organization wants, okay, is fulfillment of his objectives and his mission. So a style should align itself best to the fulfillment of that, you know. There are theories which also say, you know, we talked of individual, that is trait. We also talked of the situation, okay. And then there's a theory which says that you must have the best fit between the style and the situation to have the best outcome, okay. So we shall flag that for future research. Now, after the Iowa studies, which was in the 30s, in 1945, there was a very massive research which was commissioned by the Bureau of Business Research at Ohio State University. And what happened here is interdisciplinary teams of researchers, psychologists, sociologists and economists, right. So you see, behavioral science is really a conglomeration. There are contributions from many, many sciences, psychology, sociology, political science, social psychology, anthropology, all these sciences, they contribute to this subject of organization behavior. And they made use of a leader behavior description questionnaire. This was a little more refined. They drew up a questionnaire. What they were trying to find out is leader behavior. And the target groups were massive also. huge numbers of people in various sectors. The US Air Force, the Department of Navy's office, the civilian office, educational institutions, business companies, you know, companies, and so on. And this study set a parameter, made an assumption, non-existent definition of leadership. You know, we've been laboring today for the last 1.5 hours of what is leadership and so on. So this study said, let's keep an open blank plate. So we don't assume any definition of leadership. Let's see what emerges from this study. Two dimensions emerge as hallmarks of leadership function. And this was a very, very important finding. This is the first research which threw up two dimensions. One is a people dimension, the other is a task dimension. In this particular study, they called it consideration, which meant the people dimension, which is one of the hallmarks of leadership. And the second was, they called it initiating structure, that is the task orientation of the managers. So this was the first time, you know, it emerged that in leadership, there are two very important dimensions and there is an interplay between both. One is a leader must accomplish, so he has to have a task orientation, but at the same time, a leader has to accomplish through people, so he also has to have a people orientation and a people focus. And then thereafter, there were several other researchers which tried to pinpoint which is the best kind of behavior of a leader to have the best outcome in each type of situation. But this is a landmark kind of finding of the research. And another important thing is, you know, the veracity of the research, because there was very high consistency that these were the two dimensions which came out in study after study in various sectors with various combinations of people, various industries. So more or less it was accepted then in behavioral sciences that yes, leadership, you have two broad areas which are hallmarks of leadership. The only criticism is that the questionnaire examines and measures leadership behavior instead of the questionnaire measuring respondents' perception towards leadership. When you make a questionnaire, what are you trying to do? You take a sample of people and you try to see what is their feeling, okay, on the various questions. Here, this is one criticism which has come. Each one didn't give their own feeling. They gave appropriate answers, what they thought they should give about leadership. What is leadership? The appropriate answer. And this is a problem which you have in all kinds of questionnaire research, is it not? That the respondent, instead of giving the answer of what is his feeling, he gives what is, in inverted commas, the right answer, you know, what he feels he should give, not what he actually feels, but what he feels he should give. And that is what skews the finding. This is one of the problems of using questionnaires. So people also then try to supplement it with interviews. But interviews face to face are very costly, very time consuming. So if you want large samples, you still have to use questionnaires. Then you have the early Michigan studies on leadership. This is in the 40s also, researchers from the Survey Research Center of the University of Michigan studied leadership. Do you see, most of these American universities, they had a very powerful research wing, right? And they were constantly commissioning research for which they had huge grants. So it started off, there were several studies, but it started off with a study in the Prudential Insurance Company, which is a mammoth organization. And what they did is they targeted 12 high-low productivity pairs, each pair representing a high producing section of the company and a low producing section. Interviewed 24 section supervisors who were leaders of the section and 419 workers who are of the clerical category. All right? And what did the results find? Results found that high producing sections had supervisors who were people oriented in their supervisory styles, people oriented, whereas low producing sections had task oriented style supervisors with low concern for people. So what happened in effect? These studies, Michigan studies, it showed that at least in the banking industry, all right, with employees at the lower level, clerical, there is a correlation between productivity and leadership style. Okay. Now, someone was saying experience in the US, they found that they have got formalized, everything is rules, regulations and all that, and people perform well there. Maybe this is some kind of correlation. What do you say? It's also not a factory setting, it is an office setting. So correlation established between productivity and leadership style. All right. Now, there are several leadership theories. You can read about it in the learning material which I have highlighted. But what I have tried to do is give you a broad picture of how all these theories evolved. You know, first, if you see this, you have the individual leader. It's focusing on individual, like our discussions in the first half hour of the class, you know. We were discussing, and all these came out of discussions. You know, the great person theory. Have you seen in history Alexander the Great, Akbar the Great, huh? Great person theory. That is your great person theory. Or born leader with leadership traits. That's what we discussed. So that was the theoretical basis of leadership. They said you are born with it. Then next the thinking turned a little. He said you are not just born, but you are born with some traits. Earlier, of course, if you look at history, you had the divine right of kings, isn't it? Most of the kings, most of the dynasties, they claim that they actually originated either from the sun god or some other god. And that invested in them the right to rule. Okay. Then came the trait theory, individual leader's trait. We discussed it a lot. Traits for leadership. You have the trait. Then the focus changed slightly to embrace, bring into the fold not only the leader but also the follower, which also came up during our discussions, right? So leader's behavior and its effect on the group. So the followers came into the picture. Then came the situation that also came up during our discussions, right? That the leadership has also to do with the situation in which you are leading. Leader is shaped by the situation, combination of the right traits for the right situation. This had its beginnings in Germany, and this is a German word, Zeitgeist, which means spirit of the time. Spirit of the time means the situation, that's what they mean. Then you went into the contingency model, as you call, and it was Dr. Fiedler's contingency theory. It is recognized as his theory, which really says that you must have a fit. We discussed this, a fit between leader's style and the situation effectiveness. You must adopt the right style for the right situation to be effective. Okay. Then it went on to the path goal theory. All right. Leadership behaviors effect on the following: motivation, performance, satisfaction. And from this emerged four types of leadership styles according to Martin Evans and Robert House, who carried out this research originally. Directive style, supportive style, participative style and achievement oriented style. But the important difference that came out from this theory, or what it tried to portray, is that one person, the same leader, can use all these different types of styles in different types of situations. So, a leader is a many splendored thing, so to say. You have to have a plethora, you have to have all these styles which you use appropriately. That is a theory, path goal theory. And then you come to the contemporary, the modern, read modern as maybe last 2 decades or so, or 3 decades at the most. Charismatic theory, transformational theory, social learning theory, and substitute theory. Okay. Now, what is very interesting is the substitute theory. Anyone knows what is the substitute theory? What is it? Substitute theory. Srivats, what do you think is substitute theory of leadership? You substitute a leader, get a pretender, a fake leader put in there, for what is it? What it really means is in some situations and with some people, there is no need for a leader, that is the theory. Example, he says there are certain professionals, you know, or professions. One of the examples is professors, you know, that is in the knowledge area, or today you may say, you see, software engineers and so on. They are so equipped with their professional knowledge and the knowledge for the task which they are carrying out, that they do not really require any leadership support. The leader is substituted by his professional expertise and knowledge. Okay. There is another example. You know, there are people for whom material rewards are not very important. And such people, all right, do not require any kind of leadership with a reward and punishment issue. They are self-motivated, they do not care much for rewards. So, you see how interesting this is. This theory which says you really do not require leaders in some, it goes back to the statement earlier about leadership being a myth, right? Created to uphold our social system beliefs of hierarchy and so on.
Not a group of people working for a common goal. I mean, that is not coming up.
Well, if in a research organization, let's say CSIR, if you have a national lab where you have scientists of repute, they are working, their satisfaction. You see, which leader is going to contribute to them, because they are experts in some line or the other. That is one. Second is, they can earn name and fame and admiration in their particular line, you know, by the papers they publish, right, or the patents they come out with. They don't require rewards from the CSIR organization giving 3 increments. That's not important. They may consult, they get sponsored research, in which case they have the satisfaction. People come and ask them to come and solve their problem. That itself is a reward. See, in such cases, it is not only individuals, it is a whole group working. So, in such a group and to some extent educational institution, in an educational institution, there is a lot of freedom. In an academic institution, a research institution, VG SOM, there is academic freedom. The formalization, okay, is only there in administrative matters. In education matters, there is less formalization, not only here but all education institutions, because it gives elbow room and leeway for the professor to cover a curriculum, once that is decided upon, the way he wants to cover it, you see. What he feels is best for the learning of the students. And the test of that comes out when the students are examined, so that freedom is there. And therefore, a command control kind of a structure, authoritarian and so on, is just not appropriate. You know, this is the finding for education institution. You have to have far more informal. Now, think in an education institution, many of them, like IIT, you have in rotation a head of department, is it not? Because this pyramidal structure is kind of absent. They are all colleagues. Okay? Now, the only difference is Viji Som. The dean doesn't rotate. Why is that? Why is that? Dean doesn't rotate. He stays or he goes, but he's no one else comes and then he steps down, and that doesn't happen. I think the probably reason is this is the American model which has been followed. Because in America, okay, all universities have a president, okay, and all the faculty, major faculties like medicine or dentistry or business school, they have the deans who are supposed to be the administrative head. And then the deans have a choice whether they want to be a teaching dean also or a non-teaching dean. So, that freedom is given to them. Many of the deans are professors, you know, who then choose not to teach because of the heavy administrative work. So, when they assume deanship, they don't teach. But they may go back, you know, and take a professorial appointment. So, that is the substitute theory. The rest of it, I think, you read up, all right. And today we come to an end of our session, all right. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed. This learning is going to be more interactive, all right, because in leadership, I have no formula to give you, all right. We will try and have case studies, but let's wait for 2 or 3 lectures. We'll cover a bit of theory. And then we'll go into that. And as I said, I've tried to bring a lot of practical elements into this program. So we will have other leaders coming and giving these leadership lectures. Satya Prakash gave a lecture. Then we had the transformational kind of leadership, you know, this, which was a very good example given by Mr. Bhushan Raina. And we'll visit that also. We'll visit that factory. Maybe around the end of this month, and then see the finer points of how you bring in a transformation. Okay? Thank you very much.